morning. Welcome to our Sunday worship service. I'm Brandi Urey, and I'll be your celebrant this morning. I'm grateful to have this chance to meaningfully connect with all of you today. As a wife, mom, foster mom, and kindergarten teacher, I spent a lot of time as an imperfect person in the company of other imperfect people. See? Okay, as long as I'm not popping the peas, right? Okay. I always tell my students,
are we picking up?
It's coming through, but I just can't hear it like on the speakers.
So I always tell my students, it's hard to be a people. Especially with other people. But it gets easier with, and that's my cue for them to say, practice. Let's explore together what this practice can look like for each of us. I'd like to extend a special welcome to all of those who are joining us for the first time today. We're very glad you're here. If you've come in person, you should have received a welcome packet with information card in it. If you fill that out and drop it in the offering basket, we'll be in touch to support you in finding your way into our community. If you're joining us online, there's a link on our website to an electronic version of that same card. Our welcoming committee members have yellow name tags and can answer any questions or point you toward additional information. Whether you are new or not, please consider staying for coffee and conversation after the service, either downstairs in our fellowship hall or in our Zoom room. And now, let's say our words of welcome together. Whether this is your first or your thousandth Sunday with us, and whether you strolled, rolled, zoomed, ran, or danced in, we are glad you chose to join us. We are one people of many beliefs, identities, origins, sexualities, and genders. All are welcome here. Now we'll take a moment to say hello across the technical divide. First, we're going to show the people joining us on Zoom. If you're at home, please turn on your camera. Now, people at home, wave. Now, people who are attending the service in our building, it's our turn to wave. Hi, Al. Well, now, just like Laura showed us, I invite you, those of you who are in the sanctuary, to greet one another with a nod, a handshake, a smile. And those of you on Zoom might type a greeting in the chat. We do have a couple announcements this morning. Our next installment of Parent Group will be this Wednesday, July 26th. This is a place for any parent and or caregiver to find community and support. Everyone is welcome. We provide dinner and then childcare while the grown-ups get a chance to connect and talk. Next week is a fifth Sunday. Our fifth Sunday offering next Sunday will be to benefit Stuff the Bus, a Kiwanis-sponsored drive to collect school supplies for kids from families where money for school is tight. Donations of school supplies as well as money will be very welcome. A list of supplies needed is posted on the bulletin board in the Friendship Hall. And finally, this fall, UUCP is launching a new program called UU Wellspring. an intense 10-month small group program of spiritual transformation and UU identity formation. If you're interested, there'll be a table set up at coffee hour where you can get more information or sign up for the program. Go see Ryan Urey about that. And here end the announcements. We preface our service by acknowledging our church is built upon the ancestral homelands of the Nimiipuu, called Nez Perce by the French speeding traders, the Palouse, and the Chechumts, called the Coeur d'Alene. Let us pause and remember that we live on ground that is sacred, ground that was stolen, ground that cries out for justice and responsible stewardship. May our remembering help us find the courage to do our part to restore wholeness to the earth and all her peoples.
Winter's day in a deep and dark December. I am alone, gazing from my window to the streets below on a freshly fallen silent shroud of snow. I am a rock, I am an walls, a fortress deep and mighty that none may penetrate. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. It's laughter and it's loving I disdain. I am a rock. I am an of love. Well, I've heard words before. It's sleeping in my memory. I won't disturb the slumber of feelings that have died. If I never loved, I never would have cried. I am a rock. I am an my books and my poetry to protect me. I'm shielded in my armor, hiding in my room, safe within my womb. I touch no one and no one touches me. I am a rock, I am an island. And an island never cries.
Thank you so much. We're hoping that folks joining us via Zoom have a chalice or other candle to light, and something to light it with. Let's light our chalices together. In the light of truth and the warmth of love, we gather to seek and seek to share.
Please be seated. Good morning. I am the Reverend Dr. Elizabeth Stevens, and I am lucky enough to serve this congregation as its minister. And my thing is going to make me sign in. I'm sorry. Some mornings, the tech gremlins are in full force. Okay. So, the guiding question for our worship series this morning, or this summer, is what helps you craft a meaningful life? If you've been in worship the last 2 weeks, you've heard my two of the top three answers to that question. Spending time in nature keeps me sane and grounded, and cultivating self-understanding and self-awareness, the fine art of navel gazing, keeps me learning, growing, and deepening. And today, I'm going to offer a third answer, peopling. Now, what do I mean by that? A few months into the pandemic, the shine of the new technology had worn off, and I was struggling. I wasn't enjoying spending most of my day staring at a computer screen. I didn't find preaching to the little black dot particularly rewarding or meaningful. And I was exhausted. I was really struggling to keep going. So I also was sharing my house with three young adult males, all of them pretty introverted, pretty nerdy, and you know, they were perfectly happy spending most of their day on their computer screens. But I sat them down and I said, okay, so I have a job, and my job involves a lot of peopling. And I like it that way, and this is the job that keeps the roof over your head and pays for the Wi-Fi. So with COVID, I can't people with my people anymore. So you are the people with whom I am allowed to people. Therefore, you shall present yourselves at 5 o'clock each evening for peopling time. I will provide snacks and drinks, and you will provide actual real life three-dimensional conversation, at least half of which has to be about something other than your games. So at the beginning, they were maybe a little reluctant, and I had to go and nag them, and they might have grumped, but within a couple of weeks, 5 o'clock would come, and I'd hear as they'd thunder down the stairs. Those of you who've met my sons also know that they're large. They'd thunder down the stairs, and if I was still at my computer, they'd stick their head in and say, Mom, aren't we peopling today? So I think they learned to love it as much as I do. So that's what I mean by peopling. See, we humans are social creatures. We're not intended to exist in isolation. We evolved for co-regulation. We evolved for connection. Yet even before the pandemic, studies showed that on average, we're doing a lot less peopling on average than we used to. We moved away from family, we tend to have fewer friends, we're less likely to be part of clubs, religious organizations, or other voluntary associations. And personally, I think this trend, this shift, has contributed to some other real problems in our society, including the increase in depression, anxiety, and other mental illnesses, the increase in domestic violence, bullying, and other forms of abuse, and the increase in suicidality and gun violence. For me, if time in nature quiets my mind and navel gazing grows my soul, peopling is what heals my heart. It's what keeps me going. Perhaps that's true for some of you as well. And that's what we'll be reflecting on today together. But first, let's sing. I invite you to rise in body or spirit to join in hymn number 346 in the Gray Hymnal. Come sing a song with me.
Come sing a song with me.
take a moment to engage in the practice of generosity together. For those of you able to make a financial contribution, the logistics are on your screen. We typically give away all of the cash from our Sunday offering to local charities whose missions align with our values, a program called the Month of Sundays. This month, the recipient is Planned Parenthood, whose mission is to provide the high-quality, inclusive, and comprehensive sexual reproductive health care services all people need and deserve, with respect and compassion. To donate, please indicate Month of Sundays on your check or from the online drop-down menu. In the spirit of love and for the continuing work of this church, we will now take some time to practice generosity together.
So I really wanted to share this reading with you, but it's a little long, so I've divided it into two pieces. We're going to hear part of it as the meditation, and Sam, if you wanted about halfway through to start playing the meditation, that would be great. And then we'll hear the rest as our closing reading. So I invite you into a space of contemplation, meditation, prayer. This is God Gave Me a Word by my colleague, the Reverend Amy Petrie Shaw. I was talking with God the other day because we're cool like that, and God said, "Hey, I want you to tell people something." And I was kind of busy, so I pretended like I didn't hear. And God poked me and said, "I'm not kidding, pay attention, because while we're cool, we aren't that cool." And I know when I have pushed it way too far, so I put down my coffee cup and I turned around, and God said, "Let me hang a word around your neck so that everyone can see it. And you better speak it when you're out, because I'll know if you don't, and it will be heavy, so heavy on your soul." And a word was hung around my neck to take out to the people standing in the streets. A word was preached into my ear and laid into my mouth and burned into my heart until all I could see was the shape of the word, and the word was all, and the word was love. And God said, "Now get out, because you don't have all day, and that word is going to get heavier, and you got some work yet to do. So I'm taking my word out into the world." Love came down on this green earth. Love came down and turned over the tables and set the world on its end. Love made it clear that it was the word for the poor and the brokenhearted, for the queer boy and the angry girl, Love was the word for late night hookers and the long haul truckers, for the heroin junkies and the runaway cutters. Love was the word for all of the screwed up and pushed over and too tired and I can't take no more. Love was the word for the HIV patient and the man with no papers. Love was the word for me and for you, for the saints and the sinners and the scramblers in between. Love came down and made a way for there to be a way, and then love said, we are never going back. He who has ears, let him hear. Love said, we are all a part of something bigger, and if you cannot rise with us, if you cannot love with us, then you should get the hell out of the way, because we aren't going anywhere, and you are in the path. He who has ears, let him hear. Breathe in, breathe out, breathe. Breathe out. When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out love. When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out. When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out love. When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out love. When I breathe in, I'll breathe in peace. When I breathe out, I'll breathe out love. Breathe in, breathe. Breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. We have two testimonials today. I'm going to invite Kane forward to offer our first one. Do you have something to read from, or do you need my script? Okay, you're good.
Hello. I'm Kane Anderson. I've been a member of the church since October, earlier last year. And I initially joined due to my wife's lack of community, because she enjoyed the church community back home, but when we moved to Pullman, we didn't really get a chance to continue that. And so she wanted to start up a church community again, and this is what we decided to go with. And now that I've attended for 9 months, a lot for me personally changed, and one of those aspects was starting Warhammer as a hobby. Warhammer, for those of you who don't know, is a tabletop game that includes grown men or adults playing with tiny plastic figures and pretending that you're a part of some weird universe that is non-existent and hopefully will never be existent. And I played a lot of tabletop before I started Warhammer. I played Magic the Gathering, which is a trading card game. I played games like Pathfinder and Dungeons and Dragons as a with a lot of my friends. And most of the time, my time was just spent playing video games with friends over in the other side of the country or just playing by myself. And I didn't really feel like I had a lot of people that I could consider my best friends just because I never saw them in person without it being like once in a year and I spend like hundreds of dollars to fly to Florida or something. But that all changed when I started playing Warhammer just because I really enjoyed the aspect of playing something in person like Magic the Gathering, but I also wanted to mix in my hobby of painting miniatures. And me and Ashley had joked for a long time that I would probably never get into Warhammer just because it seems like a community that was a bit like too hard to get into. It was a very expensive hobby to start with, having to pay several hundreds of dollars just to even start one army. But in December, I decided to just go for it, and I gotta say it was probably one of the best decisions I've made, with the exception of the big hole in my wallet. Ever since I started playing Warhammer, I've made more physical in-person friends than I have probably over all of high school and college. Back then, I was a very introverted person. I didn't really want to be very outgoing. I did a lot of sports, but I didn't make a lot of good friends. Like, most of the time, they were just acquaintances. And I think I can count as many people that are good friends on one hand from high school and college. But that changed with Warhammer, just because I was able to meet a lot of people. I've grown more into the community of Palouse Games and just the Warhammer community in general. I know at least 20 people that I consistently talk to every day now, and so I guess what I have to say is that Warhammer has made me into a more outgoing person, and it's made me more willing to be invested in one part of a community than I've felt in a very long time. I believe that's really all I have to say about that, just because there's not much to it. Like, I just like to play games with people, and it's just a big part of my life now, so.
Asked to talk about cultivating relationships, I was overwhelmed with ideas to share. I considered speaking about how pivotal supportive relationships helped me to begin to heal from trauma and broke me out of destructive addiction cycles. Thought about sharing bullet points from a foster parent training called trust-based relational intervention. Come see me if you want to talk about that. I could talk about that for hours. I considered sharing strategies that I use with my kindergartners, the million ways I build a classroom family each year. Turns out herding cats is easy when you know what makes each one purr. I have a lot to say on this topic because I've had lots of practice. It seems the universe has provided me a lifetime of lessons on why relationships built upon trust, safety, connection, and shared joy are worth every bit of effort. Because the universe also brought us Taryn. Now, most of the congregation knows him, but for those of you that don't, my 5-year-old son, Taryn, is the loud little dancer often up in the balcony. He's the one who leaves sets of 5 things randomly all throughout the RE classrooms. And he was diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder level 3, the most impacted, when he was 2 years old. This made cultivating a meaningful relationship with him a completely different ballgame. Suddenly, my number one go-to strategy, honest and open communication, couldn't help me. I struggled to connect with Taryn beyond meeting his basic needs, which was done through process of elimination while he melted down. None of us were happy with the shape our family was taking. It's hard to communicate with someone when you don't speak the same language. You need to depend on other cues, body language, tone of voice, pointing. None of that worked with him either. Miserable and knowing, we needed help. We began the process of diagnosis and early intervention. The doctor who diagnosed him gave us the best advice we ever got. Don't worry about anything else right now. Get him hooked on faces. Get him hooked on people. The time we balked, we wanted to jump to whatever quick fix would help us communicate with Taryn. But you can't have a good relationship with someone you're trying to fix. And as he would go on to show, he wasn't broken. Unsure of where to start, I simply sat near Taryn and offered my presence while he played. Slowly, I became more attuned to his inner world. I observed how he stacked or lined up specific objects, and I began to see meaningful patterns emerge. I listened with curiosity to his utterances, his well-known and simple nursery rhymes, and I recognized moments when his scripts actually related directly to what he was doing. One day, he sang the first line to a song, and then I jumped in and sang the second line. I got the best eye contact I'd ever seen from him before, and he sang the third line, like waiting for me. So I finished off the melody. Turned out, I'd finally learned his language, song. You don't always get to meet someone halfway in a relationship. Sometimes you have to go 60% of the way, sometimes 90, sometimes 100. But the moment you make contact and know someone deeply, it's all worth it. Now, Taryn and I have connected. I don't have to give 100% anymore. It's closer to 80. But it shifts more and more each day. Taryn taught me that the most rewarding relationships are the ones you put the most effort into cultivating.
We'd like to do a John Prine song.
We had an apartment in the city. Me and Loretta, we liked living there. It's been years since the kids have grown a life of their own. They left us alone. John and Linda live in Omaha. Joe is somewhere out on the road. We lost Davey in the Korean War. I still don't know what for. Doesn't matter anymore. And old trees just get stronger, and rivers grow wilder every day. Old people just grow lonesome, waiting for someone to say hello in there. Hello. Me and Loretta, we don't talk much more. She sits and stares out the back door screen, and all the news just repeats itself like some forgotten dream that we've both seen. Sometimes I go and call up Rudy. We work together in the factories. What will I say when he asks what's new? Nothing, what's with you? Nothing much to do. You know, trees just get stronger and rivers grow wilder every day. Old people just grow lonesome waiting for someone to say hello in there. Hello. So if you're walking down the street sometimes, you see a pair of old ancient eyes. Please don't walk by or just stop and stare as if you didn't care. Say hello in there. Hello.
Thank you. In our gray hymnal, there's a reading by George E. Odell that goes like this. We need one another when we mourn and would be comforted. We need one another when we are in trouble and afraid. We need one another when we are in despair or temptation and need to be recalled to our best selves again. We need one another when we would accomplish some great purpose and cannot do it alone. We need one another in the hour of success when we look for someone to share our triumphs. We need one another in the hour of defeat when with encouragement we might endure and stand again. We need one another when we have come to die and would have gentle hands prepare us for the journey. All our lives we are in need, and others are in need of us. See, we need one another. We also need to be needed. We need to be able to comfort and encourage and help and support and see and love one another. We evolved as social beings, and our physical, mental, and emotional health improve when we're held in a complex web of relationships. Meanwhile, our culture is trying very hard to convince us that our neediness is somehow a bad thing, a sign of weakness. The truth is that the more connected we are, the more resilient we are. This is true of individuals. We're healthier and more personally resilient when we cultivate relationships with diverse others. It's also true of communities and societies. Networks of connections allow different folks to specialize in particular tasks, increasing efficiency and ultimately freeing time and energy for creative pursuits. Peopling is, by definition, a team sport. Of course, it's also messy. It's also messy. People are messy. I like to tell the story of the two folks I know whose house, I went and stayed in their house, and everything was exactly where it should be, You know, like the first, you're looking for something, the first drawer you open, there's the thing you're looking for. It was so well thought out. And I asked them how they did this. And what they said was, well, you know, we work with people all day and people are really messy. And so we find putting order, making our house orderly and neat to be very therapeutic. So if we're going to talk about peopling, this team sport of peopling, we need to try and give it some structure. And one of the people who gave it some structure was a psychologist named Bruce Tuckman. Back in 1965, he was researching group dynamics. This is going to sound familiar to a lot of you, but I think it's worth thinking about in this context. He's the one who came up with the process of group formation, storming, right? Forming, storming, norming, performing, and adjourning. We heard those before? Right, okay. So just a quick review. In the forming stage, people are functioning largely as autonomous individuals. Everyone's on their best behavior, and the work is getting to know each other and figuring out what needs to be happen, what needs to happen, who's going to be responsible for which tasks. And because people are messy and relationships are messy, what comes next is pretty inevitably conflict. Conflict turns out to be an important part of building relationships. Even here, where we live under the tyranny, the conflict-avoidant tyranny of Northwest Nice, resilient communities are places where people see differences of opinion and all of the places and ways we rub against one another as opportunities to adapt, learn, and grow. Just like our muscles get stronger by healing from micro tears, our relationships get stronger when we work through problems, when we engage in practices of repair. So that's the stage that Tuckman called storming. Next comes norming, a time of settling into patterns that work for the group. People get to know each other well enough to specialize. We learn to play to one another's strengths and make allowances for one another's weaknesses and peculiarities. I like to remind people that the point when you come to church, we don't want to say, welcome to church, here's how we do things. We want to say, welcome to church. What do you need so that you can feel comfortable here, so that the norms are continually adapting and evolving? Once we've formed, stormed, and normed, we're able to perform, although I find it's rarely this linear. We perform, we operate as a team, we're able to achieve shared goal. The whole somehow is always more than the sum of its parts. And then eventually we adjourn. Peopling is about loving one another, but it is also ultimately always about letting go. The art of the good goodbye is one that we must all study and practice as we move through our lives. So we exist as unique individuals, but we learn the shape of our uniqueness by entering into these networks of relationships. They're fluid and dynamic. None of us on our own can accomplish much of anything. But as we come together in these increasingly complex networks, miracles become possible. I truly believe that given the scope of the problems that we're facing in this historical moment, the only way we're going to survive is if we come together and keep coming together in as many different ways and constellations as possible. We need people in our lives who we can rely on to love us and to offer us unconditional support. People who are easy to be with and easy to connect with. People who will protect us, who keep us safe when we're hurt or vulnerable. People who offer softness and warmth. I wonder who those people are or have been for you. Can you bring them to mind and offer them some love and gratitude? We also need people in our lives who challenge us, who push our buttons, who force us to consider alternate points of view. These are the folks who help us figure out who we are and also who we are not. These are the work that we do to build and maintain those connections, to find a spark of connection and build a bridge filament by filament, they're often our greatest teachers. So who have those people been for you? Who are they for you? Bring them to mind offer them love and gratitude as well. We need people in our lives whose experiences are similar to our own so that they can normalize our responses. No one travels exactly the same path as anyone else, but knowing someone has traveled a similar path and is farther along, that gives us strength and hope. Helping people who are traveling a path that we've moved further along allows us to see and celebrate how far we've come. So who are these people for you? Bring them to mind and hold them in love and gratitude. We need people in our lives whose experiences are so different from our own that they explode our assumptions about what is normal. Maybe their stories break our heart and inspire us to change. Maybe their stories break open our minds and shift our perception. Who are those people for you? Let's hold them in our mind's eye, sending love and gratitude. People we admire, our role models, help us recognize and cultivate our strengths. People who rub us the wrong way and get on our nerves offer clues to our shadow self, mirroring back the qualities we possess that we wish we didn't. Who have your role models been? And who are the folks that make you twitch? Lift them up in love and gratitude as well. Now I'm hoping that having gone through this process, each of you is holding a vision, an image of love and gratitude, holding this wide network of folks. But if what has come up is a recognition that you need more or different kinds of relationships, I want to urge you to be gentle with yourselves. Remember that the culture right now conspires against this interdependence that we need so desperately. Be gentle, but also listen to that voice that calls you to admit what you need, and then ask for help in finding it. All our lives we are in need, and others are in need of us. So let's commit together then to this sacred and very human practice of peopling. Let's people as often as we can with as many folks as we can. May we embrace an ethic of community care, which means admitting we have needs just as often as we work to meet other people's needs. These days, you are among the people that I get to people with. Again, thank God. And believe me, I give thanks for that fact. Every single day. I love you all. Amen. Blessed be. Our closing song is a little help from my friends, and they say we can sing along on the chorus. Also, if you need to move around and stand, you're welcome to do that too.
Raise your hand if you were born before the 60s. All right. Ready? One, two, three, four. Oh, what do you think? Out of tune, would you stand up and walk out on me? Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song. I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. Oh, I get high with a little help from my friends. Oh, I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. What do I do when my love is away?
Does it worry you to be alone?
How do I feel at the end of the day?
Are you sad because you're on your own?
No, I get by with a little help from my friends. Yes, I get high with a little help from my friends.
I'm gonna try with a little help from my friend. Do you need anybody?
I want somebody to love.
Could it be anybody?
I want somebody to love.
Even the love is away. I'm certain that it happens all the time.
What do you think of to turn out the lights?
I can't tell you, but I know it's mine.
Oh, when I get by with a little help from my friends.
Oh, when I get tired of a little help from my friends.
Oh, I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends.
Do you need anybody?
Just want someone to love.
Could it be anybody?
I want somebody to love.
Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends.
I get by with a little help from my friends. I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends.
Oh, I get by.
Part of that reading. Love came down for the world to know, and I'm holding out this word, so even when you and God are just like that, you can't pretend you didn't know. We cannot put it down. Not for a politician spewing hatred, not for a minister vomiting out bile in the costume of a saint, not for money, or for country, or for kin. I'm holding my word in my mouth because the next time I see God, I want to be able to say, you gave me a word and I carried it just the way you asked. You gave it to me and I took it and I showed it to everyone I met. You gave it to me and I showed it to her and Ger and Z and him. I showed it to them and they and those over there. I never put it down. I can never put it down. I was talking with God the other day because we're cool like that, and God said, hey, I want to tell you, I want you to tell people something, and I was still kind of busy, so I pretended that I didn't hear, and God said, I am not kidding, pay attention, because while we're cool, we aren't that cool, and I know when I've pushed it way too far, so I put down my coffee cup, and I turned around, and then God gave me a word, and now I've given it to you. Start moving. I invite you to rise in body or spirit. Let's sing together. There is a love. May we go forth then and people with all we are worth. May we remember that sometimes the folks who are hardest to connect with offer the most precious gifts of wisdom and insight. May we be patient and kind and forbearing and gentle with ourselves and everyone we meet. I love you. Go in peace.